I guess I understand things through acceptance that I'm not supposed to understand everything and never will. I should never stress myself with trying to comprehend the incomprehensible. I accept the impossible probability of God. I accept the simplicity of Christ and the complexity of the Holy Ghost. Plain and simple. So I guess this story is about loving and fearing the unknown and dealing with anticipated situations. This is Jeff. He'll be 25 on April 30th. I've known him since the second grade. We're pretty much best friends. On Thursday, February 22nd, he was diagnosed with liver cancer. Before this diagnosis, he had visited with an internist, a neurologist, a dietitian, and a holistic doctor concerning his severe fatigue. The internist put him on some medication and referred him to a dietitian who told him to cut out sugars, including sweets and starches, as well as red meat. This didn't work, so on to the neurologist who recommended Prozac. This being out of the question, he went to the holistic doctor. Needless to say, this doctor found the answer through a series of tests. With this diagnosis, he assured him that it was only his opinion, but should waste no time in getting a confirmed second opinion. My project was already focused on fear and death, but my wallet was empty. So I suppose I chose the exploitive route by asking Jeff if he would mind if I talked to him about the situation and recorded it to share with others. He became visibly uncomfortable and most likely offended by my asking, but agreed nonetheless. I guess he hoped to get something therapeutic out of it.
So what's been going on with you for the past several months, Jeff?
Been tired a lot. Just wake up, you know, ready to go back to sleep. And just the fatigue is real. I don't know if the tiredness is caused by fatigue or fatigue by tired. I don't know. But I just don't feel like doing a whole lot. Well, I mean, I feel like doing a whole lot, but I can't. Yeah, I just can't get going.
So you went to a bunch of doctors, right? You went to an internist and a holistic doctor, I guess.
Right.
Some other people, a neurologist, a dietitian, and all that junk.
Right. They all said the same thing, but different things. And I guess the holistic doctor ran the series of fluid tests, and it came back liver cancer.
Sucks. Took a witch doctor, so to speak, to figure out what was wrong with you. And all those other guys, they just wanted to put you on antidepressants and stuff, right?
Yeah.
Gosh.
You know, I mean, I guess they, you know, the antidepressants, they think I would be depressed all the time and things like that, but they haven't had it.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, have you had anything that you might consider, like, feelings of denial about it, like it's not true or you need another opinion or anything?
I guess I want to think that sometimes, you know. I think there's somebody that would say it's a cold or heartburn or something, but the other part of me just says to take it easy.
Yeah.
You know, and just...
You were telling me that you thought, like, you finally had an answer, and that was kind of a relief, even though. So it's like you've got a this burden of what's going on with you and a relief at the same time. It must be kind of strange.
It is.
Yeah.
It's, I mean, you know, when things are not right and they, you want to know what's wrong and you want an answer, even though you're afraid, but, I don't know. There's some relief that comes with having an answer, and then there's the answer that that's the end also.
Yeah. Oh, Greta. So, I guess it's nice to have the dog around, huh? So, how do you feel about isolation? I mean, she seems to be kind of a comfort. Do you,
Yeah, well, she doesn't have a list of more doctors for me to go see, you know?
Yeah.
And, well, we don't run around the yard like we used to, do we? But, that's all right. She's so, a friend.
Is it okay for me to be around, I guess? Even though I've got this camera sticking in your face?
Yeah, that's fine, man. I mean, you know, I'm... You've been around a while too, so not that you're the dog or anything, but.
On researching the topic of people dealing with their own death, I came across a book by Elizabeth Kubler-Ross called On Death and Dying. In this book, she explores the stages a person may go through when faced with death. I thought of using this as an outline when talking with Jeff. However, stage one was denial and isolation, and at this point he appeared to experience neither. There was no denial whatsoever. He accepted it because there was finally an answer. He only wondered how he, a pretty young, active, and generally healthy guy, could ever get such a dreaded beast like cancer. Apparently, it started as chronic B hepatitis. This progressed to cirrhosis, and through the technology of a laparoscopic ultrasound, a definite diagnosis had progressed to hepatocellular carcinoma. This is the world in which he must now cope, in a world I must cope with as well, our development as friends. And as a friend, I unaffectionately and shamefully look at him in thanks that it's not me. At the same time, I want to lift his burden. Aesthetic theorist Edmund Burke wrote, "Tragedy pleases not because it is a mere imitation or because we feel safe from misfortune while pleasurably witnessing it. Tragedy pleases because in arousing pity and fear, it satisfies to some extent, though not as completely and powerfully as real-life situations might, our sympathetic nature. Terror is a passion which always produces delight when it does not press too close, and pity is a passion accompanied with pleasure because it arises from love and social affection."
I've been gone from Jeff's for, I don't know, week and a half, I guess. Hey.
Hey.
Where's your brother?
He's in the room.
Hey, Cal. What's up? Jeff! Gosh, I can't see anything in here.
There's nothing to see, man.
It's so dark in here. How's it been going?
Charles A. Garfield said, "Dying interrupts a person in the midst of life." I think that at this point, Jeff is very aware of this and he's mad. So Miss Ross's stages do apply here, the second stage being anger. Jeff is very tired of interaction with me and my annoying camera in his face all the time. I'd rather not remember most of what he said in this scene to me, so I'm deleting his audio. He's sick of phone calls, visits from old friends and family, and their sincere and not so sincere sympathies. It's obvious how he feels. This is his epigenesis, the manifest form and behavior of his dying organism. He's recoiling from people. He's even distanced himself from the sun, drawing the blinds in an attempt to block out the world. His environment for the past 3 days has been bedroom and bathroom. I am an intruder to his environment, so I'm going to leave him alone for a few days.
So what would you like, what do you think you would like to have done that you think you might not get to do?
Just that girl for one thing. Maybe she'll come to the funeral though. They all come to the funeral though. Especially if they didn't like it, because then they feel really bad. That's kind of cool. But, I don't know. I used to like going to the lake. Don't have the energy to do that anymore. Even if I did, I'd probably fall asleep or something on the way there. I'm just playing with my nephew like I did. I guess I'll miss not being able to have kids.
Yeah.
Like my sister did. Won't be able to chase the dogs off.
Yeah.
That dog.
There goes your nephew. Look at him. Hey, Greta. There he goes. Tell me one more thing. What do you think about... where are you? What do you think about evolution?
Evolution?
Yeah.
I think it's a bunch of crap.
Why do you always have that camera? You're a geek.
You're a geek.
Yeah, no, you're a geek. We're both a geek.
I came back to spend time with Jeff after a couple of days, and he was thrilled to see me again. He seemed peppy, yet underneath this seemed to lurk a fearful want for a way out. It's like it all just hit him after 3 weeks and he realizes that this is it. He talked about kids, his living parents, and wondered why him, and why now. In The Origin of Death, George Wilde speaks of our molecular ancestry, our feeble beginnings, and in my own opinionated disagreement, I do find redemption in what he writes. We have fallen in love with the body. That's the thing that looks back at us from the mirror. That's the repository of that lovely identity that you keep chasing all your life. And as for that potentially immortal germplasm, where that is 100 years, 1,000 years, 10,000 years hence, hardly interests us. In this, I've discovered that even if there is no golden eternity, the kingdom I seek every day, I'm eternal already. I've been eternal. I am a product of generations, a son of Adam, and now I'm already living on through my son and the child that's on its way. A part of me is already continuing, and that's a comforting thought. But what about Jeff? After a while, he sighed a big sigh as if he'd made his last bargain, stage 3 from death and dying, and had to settle for the price at a loss. Despite all this, his spirits do seem to be lifting. In Voices of Death, Edwin Schneidman says, "We see that people can stand sometimes shaken, sometimes unshaken above adversity under the conditions of severe stress. These precious rudders show us that, by and large, when put to the ultimate test of a direct threat of death, the human spirit as a victim does not fail. And his spirit has definitely not failed."
I look bad, huh?
No, you look fine.
I'm dying, you know.
No, you're living.
Come on, Jason, good grief. You're documenting it with a video camera.
I'm sorry, man. I'll turn it off.
No. It's alright. I'm fine. I'm okay with it. You can still be with me when I'm gone.
Do you want to talk about God at all?
Sure.
What do you think is going on out there? It's all that.
Well, I know that, all things work for the good. I just wish something bad hadn't happened to me.
Yeah.
But I'm alright. I'm alright with it.
Yeah.
I'm not afraid anymore. I was at first. I don't know where I'm going.
Again, I quote Edmund Burke. He wrote, "No passion so effectually robs the mind of all its powers of acting and reasoning as fear. For fear being an apprehension of pain or death, it operates in a manner that resembles actual pain. I feel both fear and pain. Pain knowing he's fading away, and fear at his acceptance." Back to Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's stages, she says of acceptance, "Acceptance should not be mistaken for a happy stage. It is almost void of feelings. It is as if the pain had gone, the struggle is over, and there comes a time for the final rest before the long journey," as one patient put it. This is also the time during which the family needs usually more help, understanding, and support than the patient himself. John Keats said, "I am certain of nothing but the holiness of the heart's affections and the truth of imagination. What the imagination seizes as beauty must be truth, whether it existed before or not. So the beauty must be that this truth has allowed him to accept. He's going, and he knows it." This haunted mystery, my heart aching with equal amounts of fear and love, is wrecking me. Biologically, we're bound for glory land. I've been working on dying since the day I was born. I just didn't know how soon we'd all wind up there. Sir Francis Bacon wrote, "The pencil of the Holy Ghost hath labored more in describing the afflictions of Job than the felicities of Solomon." And I guess that's just how it is.
What did you want from this life?
Just a little bit more than this, I guess.
What did you want from this life?
Just a little bit more than this, I guess.